Good morning and a warm welcome to the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee. We've received apologies from Mark Ruskell, who has other committee engagements this morning. Our first agenda item is budget scrutiny, culture sector funding. It's our only agenda item today. It's part of our pre-budget scrutiny work, and the committee is currently looking at continuing impact of COVID-19 on the culture sector and its long-term future. This will be the committee's second panel on the topic, and this morning we welcome to committee Matt Baker, orchestrator The Stove Network, Fiona Campbell, convener of Traditional Music and Song Association of Scotland, TMSA, Clara Cullen, Venue Support Manage Music Venue Trust, and Mike Jones, Managing Director of the Stand Comedy Club. And I kind of welcome you all to the meeting. We're going to move straight to questions this morning. And I remind members, when they ask a question, if they want to direct it to a particular witness, please do. I'll ask that panel member to answer first. If I could ask a general question at the beginning, both the Stove Network and the TMSA have talked about the importance of culture in wellbeing in our society, and the government have indicated they want to move to a wellbeing society. So I wonder if I could ask a little bit about the cultural social prescribing model from the Stove, and also how wellbeing society affects your organisation. So I'll go first to Mr Baker, then to Ms Cullen, and then I'll bring in the other two witnesses for an industry view on this. So if I could invite Matt Baker first, please.
Thank you, Chair. I've got lots of feedback there. Okay, we're all right. I think I should say before I start that while I sit on the National Partnership for Culture, I am in no sense representing the National Partnership for Culture today. I'm purely representing myself and the Stove Network. You're asking about wellbeing. I think what we've seen during the pandemic, as we have seen in crisis before, perhaps most notably in our own culture in World War II, the role that culture played in filling in for essential services as essential services were lost during lockdown. And we've had numerous reports from social services, etc., of the incredible role that our cultural practitioners have played filling in for essential services. And I think what I'm here today really to do is to propose a significant shift in the way that we regard culture and support it as a fundamental means of making a fairer and more equal country, and one built on climate justice as well as wellbeing. Yes, social prescribing is an important model, I think, of people being referred to cultural organisations and cultural practitioners as part of a wellbeing approach from GPs and other health professionals. But I think we need to be looking at this as a much wider range. We need to be thinking about really. When I say about changing the way that we're thinking about culture, at the moment we think predominantly we think about culture from a sort of top-down point of view of something which people go to engage with rather than something that people are involved in making. And I think that is the opportunity, that is what has been shown through the pandemic, that has been an essential part of people's well-being, that are taking part, culture as a way of them being part of initiatives in their own communities. In Scotland we have an incredible tradition, the Cayley tradition, the storytelling tradition, all of these things that have traditionally bound our communities together. And that is the way that we need to be thinking about culture in the future, of ways of cultural practitioners being part of enabling, supporting those kind of activities within our communities. And that is what is going to lead to increased well-being, increased stake in communities, increased fairness and equality as we're working from a grassroots position. So what we're proposing here is a sort of a way of looking differently at culture, of saying, let's invest significantly in that grassroots approach. The Scottish Government's Culture Collective project, 26 projects around the country, they're working on a regional basis, placing, it's a COVID proposal based on the idea of let's give culture freelance practitioners are out of work, let's put them to work in communities. We have over 250 jobs being created around the country and people working at that grassroots level. If we can continue that momentum, there's also the Creative Communities Project. If we can continue that kind of momentum, we can really build a new way and a world-leading way of the way that we're thinking about culture, and make a split then between that and the sort of culture of excellence that we're then taking people to see, in the same way that you would think about sport, as you invest in the participation in sport and you invest in elite sport. I think we should be thinking about culture in that kind of way.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Campbell, please?
Thank you for the opportunity to give this evidence, and also just want to preface everything I say today with the fact is that I appreciate what the Parliament and the Government have been doing in this time of uncertainty, but obviously we're looking to see how we can improve and go through and come out of this at the other end. So I feel like sometimes I'm being rather negative in my thoughts, but it's all to do with the idea of improvement and constructive criticism. So one of the things that I'd like to pick up, a lot of what Matt has said I would agree with. For example, the whole idea of grassroots, and I'd go one step further about sort of being very clear that we're supporting what people want to do. The voluntary sector side of things in the arts and culture is a very large base of people. And it's about understanding that a lot of those people are not necessarily working within a context where they are told what to do. They are the ones that are organizing, animating, bringing opportunities for artists into their community and vice versa. So I think that role of the grassroots and also crucially the volunteer organizer, it needs to be supported and recognized. And that's where one of the things I was in writing in my evidence paper was concerned that I, from my anecdotal information and general sort of contacts, feel that there's been some people will have fallen off that out of that pool of volunteers for various reasons. For example, they've not been well, or they've sort of got burnt out because they've been doing a lot of extra work than they may normally be doing above what they might be doing, just usually organising an event or some of those things, because a lot of them have been going and trying to sort of make connections with people on a personal basis. For example, there's the groups that I'm aware of that singing, where people have been going and sort of visiting in gardens or singing outside, or just trying to sort of make sure that social aspect of culture isn't lost. And that's actually one of those key elements of well-being. I mean, we've been talking about people's isolation and their resilience, and people who have got some of those kind of cultural activities that they can maintain either individually or on a group, maybe online, have generally been having a better experience than necessarily people who were isolated, you might say, in the first place. And that's where I come back to another issue, is that I think a lot of the structural problems and the issues that we're looking at today and in the evidence papers were actually there already. But they've been more exposed and exacerbated by the pandemic, because the fragility of the systems has been tested and in some cases found wanting in many cases. So I think that's, if we can improve on that in general, I think it will make us more resilient for anything like that happens like this again, and also makes that shift that Matt was talking about. I mean, for me, I termed it as real support and understanding of the role of cultural activity in everyday lives. I sort of feel there are people who still have this view that, oh, we don't need the arts, we don't need culture, we don't need craft, it's just sort of, and they use the word amateur in such a manner that is judgmental rather than necessarily meaning for the love of it, where it comes from. And it's seen as a luxury and it's not really important, when actually I think there's been a lot more evidence through the pandemic that it's become a very crucial way of people coping. And it was there already, but again, it's become more clear that that's one of the ways that they keep going. I made reference to a group, Forget-Me-Notes, which it has a couple of professionals running it, but there's amateur and volunteers around them. And they made a link with a singing group in Plymouth through the online Zoom sessions they were running. And I know one of the people in Plymouth actually fed back that they had actually, they, I mean, they live with a partner, but they felt like if they hadn't had these twice weekly singing sessions, they would have found it more difficult to get through the pandemic or the lockdowns because they have a history of depression. So they were sort of like found it really helpful to be able to keep singing because they are a singer. So that's where the well-being issue is important for me, that we recognise that fundamental role of culture in everyday lives, as well as also when it's a special item or a special event. And I'd like to again re-endorse a lot of what Matt was saying as well.
Thank you very much, Ms. Campbell.
Thank you.
Can I bring in Ms. Cullen, and then I'll come to Mr. Jones.
Hi, thank you so much for having me. I'd like to just reiterate and agree with what Fiona was saying, is that a lot of these issues that COVID-19 and this crisis have revealed were already there prior to the crisis, and they've been amplified because of the crisis, whether that be relationships between venues as tenants and their landlords, or access to creative funding. So for example, prior to the crisis, the grassroots music venue sector didn't really have access to cultural funding. It wasn't part of Creative Scotland's regular funding organisations. And whereas in this crisis, for the first time, grassroots music venues had their own fund. So it's called the Grassroots Music Venue Stabilisation Fund. And that was the first time our sector had access to this type of support. And so that was a really huge breakthrough and a huge step forward in terms of, I think, Scottish Government recognising the role of grassroots music venues as inherently part of the cultural fabric of Scotland. And so going forward out of this immediate crisis phase and looking towards how do we move towards stabilisation and then hopefully recovery before we can kind of address issues of well-being and kind of those sort of causes and issues, I think going back to stabilising the sector is going to be incredibly important. And in order to do that, we're going to need to focus within the cultural remit on things like structure, so the kind of organisational ownership model of the sector, improving things like ventilation so that longer term issues are addressed, so that eventually there's more security within the sector, and hopefully more security in the sector means that we can then continue kind of focus on well-being and mental health and the people who work in the sector as well. But without stabilising it first, it's going to be difficult to do that.
Thank you very much. Mr. Jones?
Well, I guess one the arts and the cultural sector at its best, it's all about making connections and giving people, whether they're audience members or participants in a workshop, that sense of connectedness, the sense of community, place, sense of belonging. Obviously, in a comedy context, you know, there's nothing better than being in a room full of people where everybody is having a great time, and the particular one of the peculiarities of comedy as a live art form is that actually the audience is a key participant in the events, and if you've got an audience that isn't engaged, then the show can die. But if the audience is fully engaged, it helps lift the whole experience, and there is, you know, and the performers thrive on that, and it becomes a virtuous circle. And if you're, as somebody who puts on events, if you're stood at the back of the room and seeing, you know, 100, 150, 200 people all having a good time, you know, there's very definitely a sense of, well, you know, job done. Clearly, during lockdown, we missed that. the real life experience. But what we did recreate was a live stream show beamed directly from the Edinburgh Club on a Saturday night to try and recreate that sense of community. Obviously, it was very different. You know, comedians playing into a camera is a very different thing, and some were better at it than others. But what we did is we tried to create other elements of that sense of being part of the experience. So we had, you know, using live chat and social media, we had virtual heckling and people kind of commenting on what they'd just seen and directly feeding into the show, and really developed a sense of community. When we first tried to do that, we had no idea whether or not people would tune in. We had hundreds of thousands of people over the course of, I think there was a total of 24 broadcasts over a 14-month period. And a lot of those people were repeat viewers. And the other thing, just briefly to mention, is we that was free to watch, but we did encourage people to donate if they'd had a good time. And boy, did they donate. We had a total of 200,000 individual donations, which is a key part of our ability to survive financially, but really, you know, showed us that we had, you know, a very strong brand and a whole bunch of people out there that did feel that connectedness with us as an event producer. And obviously we're now trying to capitalize on that as we start to rebuild and get people back in for, you know, what at the end of the day is the proper live experience. But we were, you know, pleased to be able to have tried to develop that sense of community and connectedness throughout lockdown.
Thank you very much. I was watching quite a few individual performers who had a virtual tip jar when they were working during COVID, which is quite interesting. So thank you. I'm going to move on to questions from the committee, and can I invite Ms. Boyack first, please?
Thank you very much, convener. I wanted to pick up the issue of employment. That was a really good discussion about wellbeing. Thinking about the context of keeping people in employment in the live music sector and the cultural sector came very strongly across in some of the evidence, the written evidence you've submitted to us already, of the importance of the employment side. I think in the Music Venue Trust, you talk about 1 in 11 jobs are in the creative industries. I think that might surprise a lot of people. Last week, the evidence from the Musicians Union said that about a third of musicians were thinking of leaving the sector. So in the context of this year and now, our job is looking at what should the budget look like. Can you say a bit more about what do you think the short-term measures are that would help both retain people in terms of employment in the sector, but also make it resilient as we're not quite through the pandemic yet? And maybe if I could start off with Clara Cullen from the Music Venue Trust, because that issue came out in your evidence. And then I was maybe thinking about moving to Matt Baker from the Stove Network, because you were talking about the importance of retaining culture staff. And then the others would come in afterwards. So maybe over to you first, Clara. What can we ask for directly now that would keep the sector going and keep people in jobs?
Yeah, absolutely. So I think, like, as you correctly noted, in our sector, the staff are really doing probably five jobs at once, because the infrastructure of a venue, you might be running the venue, you might be promoting, booking, managing the bar. And so it's sort of often it's one person doing a number of jobs, and then they're being supported by their team members as well. And so at the moment, we're not sure of the full impact of the COVID-19 crisis. I think we're on staffing. I think we're going to see that in the coming months, hopefully, as the sort of dust settles and we can get a better assessment of the full impact on staffing. But in terms of retaining staff, I think it's recognising that grassroots music venues act as hubs for really training and development throughout the creative industry. So you might join a music venue as a bar staff, and then actually you might start doing a little bit of lighting or kind of sound technicians, and then you move into doing that kind of field. And so it's really recognising these spaces are kind of training and development hubs, and how can we get funding or get kind of recognition of those, that sort of layer into the wider perception of what a grassroots music venue does. It isn't just a space for putting on music. Obviously, predominantly that's the core of the activity, but these are actually local community spaces where people can come and get their first tastes of the live entertainment industry. And often through the grassroots music venue as a kind of central hub, they learn these skills and advance through that career and go on and sometimes go on to be very big touring musicians or working in the industry in arenas. And so again, like I think Mike was saying, the grassroots level kind of acts as the sort of entry point and the beginning of that development and kind of can be the opening door to like a really amazing and wider creative field. And so how we can kind of retain those staff, I think, is a longer term question. I think often actually when you do the maths, someone working in a grassroots music venue is actually working for a lot less a pay than in other sectors, because they're doing so many different jobs and wearing so many different hats at once. And so I think there's something in a kind of philosophical sense about recognizing the worth of these spaces and the people who work in them and the people who dedicate their lives to them, because it isn't, at least at the grassroots level, usually a pursuit of money. It's because of its love and it's because of the varying kind of opportunities you get when you kind of step into a grassroots music venue. So I think it's going to be a mixture of practical steps of how do we kind of empower and enrich these people. And then I think it's a wider perceptive and philosophical question of how do we shine a light and get the recognition within the sector from a wider perspective.
Thanks. I'm also quite keen to think about how we can push for resources or where we should target them. I mean, if I look at the evidence from the Stove Network, Matt Baker, you talk about the work of the Culture Collective. You also talk about the Sistema model. What are the top priorities you would say in terms of investment now to retain people in employment, but also to keep the sector going over the next year, 2 years as we come through the pandemic? Do you want to pick up that issue?
Thank you very much, Sarah. Yes, I really like Clara's idea of the training and development hubs, and I think that's partly the root of it. What I'd like to say there is about retaining the cultural workforce. I think if you'll forgive me, just a little example from where we are of that training and development hub idea. The Stove has pioneered idea of creative placemaking. So we're a community development trust, the only one in the UK that's run by artists. And we've grown to be a social enterprise with a turnover of $500,000 a year, employing 10 local people in creative partnership projects in communities, supporting, crucially supporting the growth of the cultural and creative sector. We're best known for initiating a community buyout at Dumfries High Street, which people might have heard of as the Mid-Steeple Quarter Project. And I think that kind of idea, what Clara is talking about, is the same kind of idea, but at a different scale of approach. That by investing in projects at community embedded level. So what I would be advocating for is a national investment of community embedded art programs that would provide stable, fair work income for the cultural workforce and support the freelance economy. And if regional and city programs were coordinated, could also support teams of associate skills in production, event delivery, arts administration, marketing, etc. And that, as you say, would along the Sistema model, artists in residence in schools, basically putting our freelance, our cultural workforce, retaining that cultural workforce by putting them to work in community settings with the infrastructure of local organisations like grassroots music venues, like people like ourselves, comedy clubs, wherever that because we have the innovation in the art sector as entrepreneurs, we know how to make things happen. And that innovation and creativity is fundamental to us getting out of the COVID situation. So training and skills would be essential in that as well, both for people seeking to start out in the sector. It's been a really fundamental part of how we have worked, of trying to break down that sense of that it's basically only entitled people that can join the cultural sector, who can afford to volunteer, but rather bringing people from disadvantaged backgrounds, people experiencing inequality, bringing those as opportunities into the cultural workforce. And we'd be doing that through, as Clara's been describing, through that on-the-job work experience, providing opportunities for career progression for people at all levels of the cultural and creative sector, and being a doorway for others to enter the sector directly from that community base. So you're maximising diversity and inclusion in the growth of the sector. And I think if you took that significant investment approach to that community embedded art program, so you're not talking about directing money at the large theatres, etc. You're talking about doing that from the bottom up. But the bit where the large theatres, etc. would come in is that you would be adding on top of that community embedded program an active research and development program that was looking at that work as it was going on, and mapping the way that it was using those other bits of infrastructural resource that we already have in the cultural sector, and seeing which bits of those are going to be useful within that new model of a grassroots cultural creation that's the foundation of our growth and progression as a country from here.
Okay, bring in Mr. Jones, and then Ms. Campbell, and then I'll come back to Ms. Boyack.
Yeah, we're at a very difficult phase at the moment with the impending ending of the job retention scheme, which has been a key part of our ability to retain some staff throughout this period. Once that ends, then we're going to be exposed again to the harsh realities of the commercial situation. And we've only just reopened our venues in Scotland. We're currently, our marketing strapline was previously live comedy every night. But at the moment we're doing, in each of our venues in Scotland and England, an average of three nights a week. And the number of customers we've actively reduced our capacity. So we're currently, physical capacity, numbers of people in the room is at about 66%. So the fact we're doing fewer events to fewer people clearly means that there's less money coming through in terms of box office and food and bar sales. So I'm in a very strange position at the moment of, as we kind of potentially fall off the end of the JRS cliff, I'm having to agree and negotiate with people reduced hours contracts that reflect the level of work we have available for people to do at a point where we're trying to grow the business. But because we're not going to be back at pre-COVID levels for at least a year, I would say that my ability to offer hours of work to people, and this is across the organization, including office staff and venue staff, it's entirely dependent on our levels of activity, which in turn is really largely dependent on the number of people that want to come and see events at our venues. The positive news is that almost everything we're putting on at the moment is selling out. So there's clearly a demand there, which we're looking to meet. But as I say, at the moment, I'm engaged in some quite difficult conversations with whether it's admin staff or box office staff or marketing staff, saying, well, we're not doing 20 shows a week across the organization. We're doing, maybe half of that. So people's working patterns are going to have to reflect that. So it's quite difficult to maintain morale and focus during that kind of process, because clearly what we want is, as we grow the business, all of our staff to be engaged on that. But if you're limiting their input consciously, then that's quite a difficult equation to square.
Ms. Campbell?
She's muted.
We're seeing you now, Ms. Campbell, but we're not hearing you, unfortunately. I'm looking to our sound engineer. Is Ms. Campbell there? I don't think she's hearing us in the room. Perhaps somebody could try and get her onboarded by phone again, if that was possible. Go back to Ms. Boyack.
That's really helpful to get the evidence there and your comments, because I was looking for that kind of short-term comment. So the comment from Mike Jones there about the importance of the job retention scheme, given that we're not out of COVID yet, but also the ideas that came from Matt Baker about linking into communities. And for me, it kind of ticked all boxes, because it's employment retention, it links into well-being, it links into communities and potentially the next generation coming through and retaining the skill set. So very keen to see that issue. So there's keeping people in employment, there's keeping venues open. Is there anything else in terms of kind of structural support that you think that we need to be looking at? I don't know if any of the witnesses want to come back in again, having heard the last comments. I don't know if Matt Baker or Clara Curran, if there's anything else you want to come in with before we move on to the next questioner around the table.
I'll go to Ms. Cullen first and then to Mr. Baker.
Thank you, Sarah. Yes, I think for us coming out of this COVID crisis, it does go back to some of the structural issues that were amplified or exacerbated by the crisis. So for us, it's the fact that 93% of all of our venues are privately owned, so private tenants and with landlords, as opposed to community owned. And so I thought it was really interesting what Matt was saying about his community scheme a few years ago, because I think moving out of the crisis to create resilience, until we address the issue of sort of long-term ownership, it's very difficult for venue managers themselves to implement schemes, whether they be improving the kind of infrastructure of venues or improving sort of their green capabilities. It's quite difficult to do if you don't actually have very long leases, or you don't have sort of security of tenure. And I think what we saw in the crisis, particularly with the Music Venue Trust Save Our Venues campaign, was there was this huge outpouring of love from the general community for their grassroots music venues. So we had local communities raising millions of pounds to save their local music venues. And I think that interaction, or what that demonstrated, was that there is a desire from the local community to be more connected to their venues. And I think moving forward, we could create resilience within the sector if we move more towards a community ownership model, or a community benefit society model, which is taking place in some of the other nations. And I think that's probably quite a concrete policy measure that could be explored to create longer term resilience. So if this type of crisis were to happen again, venues would be in a better position to react, because there would be more long term security within their actual ownership models.
Mr. Beek, oh sorry.
No, it's okay. I was going to say Matt Baker, because I think the points you made about Dumfries, I've seen that about moving into the town centre. And is that a model that you think could be applied elsewhere as we try and regenerate our town centres and link culture in?
Yeah, I think that, you know, as we're looking at our hollowed out retail town centres, the entertainment economy in our town centres is going to be vital. We're all talking about how do we make our town centres active, vibrant, places that people want to be that gravitate to. So you get footfall for new businesses, you get the and the cultural sector is incredibly good at that entrepreneurship innovation part of starting new businesses and growing new enterprises in town centres. That's what's happening in Dumfries, as I can see out of my window right now. I think Clara's point about the long-term nature of buildings, venues, is really important, and also the long-term funding. It's something that gets talked about a lot, but I mean, we're in a situation where we are constantly in getting offered, because of the success that we've had, we're getting offers to sort of say, oh, do you want to partner on this project? Which means would be opportunities that we could bring into our region for our creative sector. And we are literally stumped for capacity because we're spending so much time trying to raise funds to continue the core operation of the organisation. So we're constantly hamstrung by that, seeking short-term funding. So that would make an enormous difference to have that security. To then, you know, because the way I talk about it is that the sort of the security of some of those key organisations gives shelter for other organisations to grow up around them. So you create these kind of like clusters. That's how the creative sector works. And we're working on a regional placemaking network at the moment in Dumfries and Galloway. We're running projects in five of our rural towns around us to build capacity for the kind of way that we're working. But at that sort of infrastructural level that you guys are looking at, I think that and listening to Clara talking about community ownership, I think that there must be enormous potential here to join up with the place-based investment program, because that community sector that's being supported, you know, you could see cultural venues as part of that community sector. That isn't happening at the moment. You could also see we have to basically become a different person for the different strands of funding that we have to apply to here. Speak a different language all the time. There's also a opportunity there in the market. That's what we're seeing in particularly the rural areas in south of Scotland that I'm familiar with, that the community sector has become a vital market for the cultural sector. It's different to the cities where you have a big critical mass of cultural businesses. It's more dispersed in a rural area, and the community sector has become a vital market for the way that creative businesses as a living. But I think, you know, coming back to that idea of that community embedded work for freelancers, it basically would feed the entire cultural infrastructure. If you had that security of tenure for freelancers to work at that community level, they are also then free to go on small tours with their bands, play in the comedy clubs, or build their own new work in the theatre sector. All of that is made possible by that security of key work in community settings. Thank you. Thanks.
Yeah. I'm going to offer a chance for Mike Jones and Miss Campbell to come in very briefly on that. I'm conscious of time, and we spend a lot of time on this subject area. But if Mr. Jones or Miss Campbell want to add anything, Mr. Jones.
Just briefly, two key things for us. We're very fortunate to own our Edinburgh premises, but we rent in the other venues. We do have very benevolent landlords in Newcastle. It's Newcastle City Council, who gave us essentially a rent rebate last year, and in Glasgow, until very recently, it was the Scottish TUC who gave us 100% rent-free period from the onset of the pandemic. So, those leases will revert to, quite chunky commercial leases, but we did benefit from, you know, that short-term benevolence. In a similar vein, the rates relief which we received was invaluable as a, you know, a part of the overall funding package which we were able to access. But again, you know, that, well, that already is tapering off in England, and from 1st of April we'll kick back in at 100% in our case, which is clearly something we need to be able to deal with from a financial point of view.
I'm not sure if Ms. Campbell's with us at the moment. I don't think she's managed to get back onto the call. I'm very sorry for that. If I could move to questions from Dr. Alistair Allen, please.
Thank you very much. I was interested in what was being said in that discussion about the impact on artists as employees and as companies and as businesses. I'm interested to know about individuals as well, given how many artists or people working in the sector are self-employed. So I just wonder if any of you could say, I don't know if this is one for perhaps for Matt Jones or others, about self-employed people and their experience of lockdown.
So I'll maybe bring in Ms. Cullen first on that one, and then move to Mr. Jones and Mr. Baker.
Sure, so I can only sort of speak quite generally on this point, that the vast majority of the people who work in the creative sectors are freelancers. That's been the model for the last decade. And so this crisis has been particularly hard for people who are self-employed, and the relationship between grassroots music venues and the artists who play there, largely the artists tend to be self-employed individuals, and so getting protecting that layer of the creative industry is vital for us and the wider music ecosystem, because obviously without artists feeling like they can have a stake in this industry, then we can't promote them, we can't book them, and so everyone is worse off if that layer of the industry feels like they can't, feels like they are forced to leave the industry, and so that's my quite general point on that one.
Yeah, go to Mr. Baker and then to Mr. Jones.
Thank you. Yeah.
Sorry. Who are you wanting? Myself?
Mr. Baker, yeah.
I'll.
Sorry.
Okay, thank you. The points that I were making were basically directed at freelancers. When I'm talking about creative businesses, fundamentally I'm talking about freelancers. They are ultimately the majority of how the cultural sector works. Yeah, when lockdown first happened, we had to switch emphasis really, really quickly. We worked between wider community and supporting the cultural sector, and we're in the town centre. But nobody really lives in the town centre in Dumfries, so our community vanished. Wider community, and we focused all our efforts on supporting the freelance economy, and we found the key things really were providing work. So we had very little to start with. We started with small micro commissions that were just getting people were in lockdown, didn't know which way was up, didn't know how to continue to be creative. Everyone was in an absolute mess, but we kept people going with that, and then gradually were able to draw in through supporting communities, funding, etc., work for artists, for freelance creators, and create those commissions. But the other key bit was the need to retain network. The infrastructure vanished overnight. The creative sector functions through talking to each other, and you know that's how jobs get shared, ideas get shared, projects get started. So those key sort of like hubs, the development hubs that Cara were talking about, cultural organisations of all stripe, were absolutely vital to maintaining that network of connectivity amongst the freelancers. And we saw in people who were falling out of that were very quickly drifting away from the cultural workforce and that idea of investing heavily in a community embedded program to bring work to freelancers is fundamental. I think we are just going to lose so many of the people who have those valuable skills that have been built up over years that make us the country that we are.
Mr. Jones?
In our last pre-COVID year, we spent £1 million. We paid artists £1 million, performers across all our venues and during the Edinburgh Fringe. Almost all of those people will be self-employed, so that's £1 million that is just not flowing to that part of the ecology. And the other thing is, during the Edinburgh Fringe, we expand our operations significantly and normally take on a whole bunch of technical and production staff, all of whom will be freelancers. And I'm not aware of the status of all of those people, but and what financial support they've been able to access as individuals. But again, there's a significant chunk of our annual budget which just wasn't flowing to those people in Fringe 2020, or indeed at the recent much reduced Fringe.
Okay. Do you want to come back in, Mr.
Allen? Yeah, I was just going to ask on the back of that if you think that's had a deterring effect on new entrants, if you like, into the industry, new freelancers, and what we can do to try to overcome that. If you think that we need to rethink what we do to reassure young people who want to become freelancers in the arts that it's a thing that they can do. I'm just curious to know whether you feel it's had an effect on new people coming in. Maybe one for Matt Baker, I'm not sure.
That isn't actually something we're seeing because in our particular community the arts have been really active through the pandemic. So people have been gravitating towards it. I mean, I talked a lot about trying to make those opportunities at that community level to diversify our workforce, and that's the big challenge is to convince that sector that arts and culture is a viable career. That, you know, we focus really strongly on always paying people and paying people at good rates, so that sense of being part it's something that you can afford to be part of and want to be part of. So there is a risk there that we're as visible cultural activity diminishes, that people will drift away. But I keep coming back to that idea. If we're investing in community embedded projects, then actually the opposite is going to be true, because they are visible opportunities for people to take advantage of.
Finally, on the back of that, Mr. Baker, I was interested in what you said throughout your contribution about rebuilding from the bottom up, and the importance of small venues and small cultural activities. I please don't want anyone to take this as criticism of Scotland's large performing companies, but does this imply, in your view, anything about the balance, given that we're talking about budget here, the balance in the future that will have to be struck between larger and smaller enterprises in the arts? Has Scotland got that balance right? Is there anything you want to say about any of that?
Yes. It's that in itself is part of the root of the issue here, I think. If you take it back, I mentioned the World War II situation. Out of the World War II situation grew the Arts Council of Great Britain. The initial Arts Council of Great Britain had two very distinct strands in it. One was about people making their own culture, participation in culture, growing culture. The other was about creating culture that people went to go and see. In the early 50s, John Maynard Keynes took over as the minister responsible, and he did away with that strand of the making your own culture. And that's where we have lived with that vision of culture and the way the culture is funded from a public point of view ever since, focusing on making excellent culture and then making that accessible for people. I think we do need to look at that differently. But just turning around to Creative Scotland and saying, deal with your budget differently, is not an answer. Creative Scotland has a tiny budget, but we, you know, because what I'm suggesting is that we need to go back to that original Arts Council vision of two strands of the way that we're looking at culture, participating, making your own culture, and viewing top-notch culture. We need to look at ways that we can bring in money to feed that other strand, because really what we're investing in culture at the moment will really just maintain that first model of culture as something which is to be consumed by the public rather than made by the public. So we need to look at a way of funding that making in public, and that's where I think we need to be creating significant alliances with the health sector, with the education sector, with the regeneration economic development sector, and not being afraid to say that culture has a part to play in all of that, and the way that we're making that transition around climate as well.
I think Ms. Campbell is back in the room and wants to come in on this. I've asked if people do want to answer a question, it's been directed to someone else, if they could put an R in the chat in blue jeans, so that we can, it's very difficult to do this and get a feeling, you don't get the feeling in the room that someone was desperate to answer a question, but I'll bring in Miss Campbell for now.
Yeah, hello, thank you. If I can actually talk about the two questions that have just come in before. The first one is about self-employed. We're very concerned that there's a lot of, obviously, freelancers in the traditional arts sector, and trying to make sure that they have the opportunity to either make money during the pandemic. My digital capacity today shows you some of the problems that can be can face individuals, because they may not have the capacity or the resources to buy good quality equipment, for example. So there's that, and that idea of transitional support for organisations and artists is very key. It's been already mentioned about the furlough scheme finishing. That's also accompanied by the SISS scheme finishing. So that the next 6 months is going to be key about keeping people in that workforce, whether they're through an organisation or whether they're self-employed. And this is actually an issue that's come up at the Traditional Arts Working Group, which is a Creative Scotland advisory group. There is already evidence that young traditional artists particularly are looking at different careers or already moving into different careers because there's just not the work there, and they have to put food on the table, they have to keep roofs over their heads as well, etc. And the music isn't paying its way at this point in time for obvious reasons. I mean, we don't necessarily need to repeat those. But a point that I was going to make, supporting the Clara's points a lot, that idea of stabilisation of venues, making them available. I'm aware of a folk festival at the moment who's having difficulty getting a venue for their usual festival in November. So that's the issue about venues being able to take on events, being organised by volunteers, for example, employing people, artists, is one of the issues. It's not just about access to artists, it's also access to venues, and the venues being confident about being able to be ventilated properly, etc. And I think a lot of it comes back down to what Matt was saying about the difference in the funding structure. A lot of this is related to how well people have been core funded or not core funded, and a better spread of core funding would be a good starting point, because some people don't need a lot, but they may need less than what, for example, when Creative Scotland did the fairly recent regular funded application round, it was a minimum of £50,000 you had to apply for each year, when not every organisation needs that amount. So they sort of, you had to sort of inflate your budget to meet that criteria to be able to apply. So there's definitely areas that we could be improving on. And one final point about the entrance for new people. Obviously, a lot of people get their first taste, as Clara was saying, in music venues, but there's also a lot of voluntary organisations and festivals and events that they cut their teeth on as well and get an idea whether they'd like to make a career out of it. So that's where I think the issue about not having some of these events and festivals running in the usual capacity where you need volunteers to be at the gate to look after the artists, etc., means some of the usual pipeline are not currently operating in the same way, except for maybe when they need some digital help. That's maybe where they come into their own. Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. That's it.
Thank you. We'll move to questions from Mr. Cameron.
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and welcome to the panel. I'd like to just pick up on the question of funding that Ms. Campbell just spoke about. I found that a very interesting point about core funding and being spread sort of more widely. Can I come on to the issue of multi-year funding? We've heard quite a lot of evidence that there is a desire for multi-year funding because it provides greater stability. And yet, as we know, there is a kind of annual funding system. Could I get the views of the panel on whether they support multi-year funding? And if I could start with Mike Jones, please.
Well, I'm speaking from the perspective of an organisation that before COVID didn't receive any funding. The funding that we've received has been exceptional. I think all organisations need to be able to plan their business and their financial model over a 3 to 5 year period. And I think arts organisations that do require funding absolutely require certainty of funding across a broader period rather than living hand to mouth. I mean, obviously, you know, project funded organisations, that, you know, that's even more extreme. But RFOs, if they're to continue to develop artistically and commercially, and obviously there's the increasing imperatives to develop ancillary income from things like food and drink supplies. People need to know where the financial support is coming from so that they can plan and develop over a proper business cycle. So absolutely, yes, multi-year funding it would be a positive thing.
Can I bring in Mr. Baker? And if Ms. Campbell and Ms. Cullen want to come in on it, or anything they want to add, if they could put an R in the chat, but we'll go to Mr. Baker.
Thank you. Yeah, no question that multi-year funding would be a benefit, and that would need to be spread wider. I mean, the basic reason would be is that if you're on an annual cycle, you really don't get much chance to get on with the work because you're in that constant cycle of you know, applying again and again and again. So, that means that we do need to make a fundamental commitment as a country that we want to invest in this infrastructure and that it's got a value. And I think that comes back to that community point again, but I won't labour it. That, you know, and I don't think we can just look to Creative Scotland and say, spread that wider. It needs to be spread wider. You know, as Clara and Fiona are saying, there are different scales of organisation. And if we invest in those organisations, we invest in the kind of ecosystem that they support around themselves. So and Creative Scotland's RFO structure is predominant. You know, the vast majority of that money goes to large, you know, and great organisations that are sort of like effectively almost too big to fail. That you can't shift. You know, they've got so little room to manoeuvre in terms of that budget. Because if you were to say, oh, you know, sorry, Lyceum, you're out. In order to spread it a bit wider, the howls of protest that would come at national level, the political storm that would be created. The arts is incredibly good at making that kind of noise, as we've seen around the last RFO of funding round. So it does require us to look at innovative solutions for, like, and that maybe that idea of, like, looking at it as two streams, and which stream are you in, and the money from the other stream is not necessarily coming from that Creative Scotland investment in the large organisations. But I saw that Sarah Boyett was asking questions about the Cent for Art on building contracts. And that, you know, that could be an amazing commitment from the country. I mean, I'm familiar with the system in Calgary in Canada, where every city department has a percent for art, which creates these centralized funds. I think, you know, but these are the kind of innovative solutions that we need to be looking at as a country if we're going to make this commitment to our cultural infrastructure, which is sustainable. And creates the kind of country we want to see, if we believe in culture as an instrument for the changes we want to see.
I'm afraid we've lost Ms. Campbell from the call again, just to let you know, but Mr. Cameron, do you want to come back in?
Thank you very much for those answers. If I could move on to a linked issue, which is to try and look beyond COVID, if we can. And I accept that this involves looking into your crystal ball a bit. But in a year or so's time, when hopefully we're out of the pandemic, can I ask you how you think the sector, in respect of your organisations, will look? And again, how should that be funded? And I appreciate you've touched on some of this in previous answers. But if you're able to look at the kind of post COVID landscape, what will it look like, and how should it be funded? And could I ask Ms. Cullen first?
Sure. So yeah, that is a difficult question at the moment, because in terms of our members in Scotland, we have 85 music venues, which represents the vast majority of most music venues in Scotland. Some of those venues are very actively in contact with us, have used our support services in terms of kind of support access funding, the Grassroots Music Venue Stabilisation Fund, which was the first fund ever created in Scotland for grassroots music venues, and whereas others have been less in contact. And so getting a sense of the scope and the scale of the crisis, I think will probably take a little bit of time after this immediate kind of crisis phase, which is also why we're recommending some form of infrastructure audit to be undertaken, so that we can really see how COVID has impacted. Are there music venues that have shifted to just sort of doing bar and hospitality and food, or are there venues that might be sort of music venue pubs and have kind of shifted in the short term to focusing on the pub side of the activity rather than the music? So at the moment, that's a little bit difficult to tell. But going forward, hopefully, I think some of these structural questions over ownership, over the role of communities in their culture, how kind of culture can impact other ideas, whether it be health or infrastructure or high street regeneration, it presents lots of exciting opportunities as well. I think we can, there is an opportunity in, because of COVID, we don't just have to go back to how things were prior to COVID, which at least in the grassroots music venue sector was, we were not funded at all in the kind of regular funding organisation rounds. So I think it does present an opportunity to really rethink how the role of culture and how we deliver that going forward. But I think unless we address some of those structural and systematic issues that were already prevalent pre-COVID, so ownership, as Mike was saying, business rates, things like that, it's very difficult to envision recovery when we haven't yet got to stabilisation. So that's going to be an issue.
Okay. Could I bring in Mr. Jones, and then we'll go to Mr. Baker. Thanks.
I think it's really difficult to see what the landscape is going to be like. you know, the war isn't over here. There's a lot of things still to play out as we start to rebuild. But then there's still the, you know, the spectre of a winter lockdown hovering over all of this. So I think there's a real tension between the broadening of the definition of culture, which was clearly something which we benefited from, you know, an explicit commitment and recognition that, that comedy is a legitimate art form, and that comedy clubs are worthy of arts funding. That was a major box ticked for our sector. But I think, you know, that definition has been broadened, and there was a big lifeboat established into which you know, a large number of very diverse and very different cultural organisations, all with different sort of business models, were invited to jump into. I think the thing is, having broadened the definition and having said, oh yeah, you fall. Were able to help survive, how we enable those organisations to be fit for the future and able to thrive and develop from a very low point to fully deliver to their core mission and what funders are expecting them to, you know, as the key outcomes. So, going back to what Matt was saying, you know, we've got a situation here where we've said, oh well, there's a whole bunch of people here that merit our emergency funding, but we're faced with a current situation and a future situation where without that emergency funding, we're going to be looking at redistribution of essentially finite funds, and that's a huge challenge for funders.
I bring in Mr. Baker, hopefully to be followed by Ms. Campbell. Mr. Baker.
Yeah, I hope to learn and get in. I can paint a picture of the future as I see it, but I can only paint it in my immediate area in the south of Scotland. So what I envisage for the future is a creative placemaking network right across the south of Scotland. I'm talking about Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish Borders, part of the south of Scotland enterprise area. within that, a number of key nodes that would be community organisations, cultural venues, who are each got a degree of core funding and each supporting a cohort of creative freelancers around them. So you've got that cluster. Then through the fact that you've got that network, you have the opportunity to share capacity, share experience, share programming, share physical kit and resources. And you build with that, as we've been doing, a kind of strategic partners framework around it, from the community sector, from the health sector, from the education sector, from the economic regeneration sector, from the skills development sector. We've been working Skills Development Scotland a lot. And that grows that larger mass of potential capacity and delivery. So you've got support that's supporting your freelancers. It's giving them the capacity to build new work. And through that, through the profile and advocacy and collective bargaining that you have as a network situation, you have the opportunity to link to national and international projects delivery, so that you can bring National Theatre down to south of Scotland to work effectively within communities and direct to communities, and do the same with international projects. And then if you join that up all the way around Scotland as a network of linked funded basic nodes, you've got an amazing vision of a sustainable creative future for Scotland.
Thank you. Can we bring Ms. Campbell in?
Hi, sorry. I'm going to go on again about digital capacity. the issue for me is that I'm getting feedback now.
Yeah,
That should be fine. What I've got is the...
Ms. Campbell,
sorry, apologies, this is a digital... Can you hear me now?
It's no.
We've
got echoes and things. If you could, I'm really sorry about this, but if you could remove yourself from the call, I think we'd be able to proceed.
Okay, all right,
sorry,
okay,
thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Can I bring in Ms. Minto, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. I was really excited to hear about your vision, Mr. Baker, for Dumfries and Galloway and the Borders and the rest of Scotland. I'd really like to hear a bit more about how you plan that to work, and if how we do actually move forward to have that across Scotland. I'm very sorry that Ms. Campbell has just left, because I had a specific question with regards to rural festivals and the impact of all the requirements and lack of travelling, and the impact that has not only on the performers but also on the communities, because there would have been a lot of well-being and benefit from them. And also, I'd just be interested in the point that also, I'm afraid, Ms. Campbell made with regards to the minimum level of funding being set at 50,000. Now, I know, coming from a rural community, that £10,000 goes much further there than it might in the centre of Edinburgh, for example. So any of the panel's thoughts on that would be useful. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Minto. And I'll maybe ask the clerks to follow up with TMSE for the questions that haven't been able to be answered for a written answer,
thank
which
you.
Would be helpful. Mm-hmm. But I'll go to Mr. Baker first for that one. Thanks.
I'm sorry, there were several questions in the journey. I'm aware we've got shorter time, so was there anything particular you wanted me to?
I think I was really pleased to hear when you started talking that you had you were envisaging a network across Dumfries and Galloway. So I'm interested to hear more about how you're planning to expand that throughout, from Dumfries to the likes of Kirkcudbright, Castle Douglas, etc.
Exactly. Well, I mean, I mentioned the Culture Collective project, Scottish Government initiative of $6 million across the country, 26 projects. We're one of those projects, and what we're doing is we're supporting a community anchor organisation in five towns, so in Stranraer, in Langholm, in Sankar, in Castle Douglas, and in one of the housing estates on the edge of Dumfries, in northwest Dumfries. We're supporting those groups to host two resident artists for a year, creative practitioners who are, and the community groups have identified a particular section of their community that they want to reach that have been particularly affected by COVID. So for instance, in northwest Dumfries, it's a block, there's a set of six blocks of flats that have got a particular problem with turnover of tenancies. Mm-hmm. And those practitioners are then there embedded for a year to work within those communities and bring forward. So they may be starting groups. In Castle Douglas, they're working towards completely rethinking the gala day in Castle Douglas, for instance. But what our experience has showed is what having that security of time is bringing forward small social enterprises, new groups are forming around a particular thing that people want to learn or do together. Environmental projects, it's starting community asset transfers, environmental projects that grow from those kind of initiatives. But what the amazing thing is that all of those community organisations are now working together and collaborating on joint funding bits and beginning to think of themselves as a collective enterprise. And so in past years, we've been competing for funding, and now we're talking to each other about, like, let's all go for that thing and go together, which is so much better from the funder's point of view, because they're not in a position then of how do you choose between Dunrar and Castle Douglas? You know, how are they supposed to know? Where you want to be deciding that at local level. So if you build those networks and have the ability for people to talk and build trust, and they then support a cohort of creatives around them. So it seems to be working.
Thank you. Thank you. I think that's a really interesting comment because it's maybe one of the few silver linings from the pandemic is that communities have found different ways to work together and different people have come out of communities with different ideas, which maybe helps expand cultural ideas as well.
100%, and being given, we've been allowed to think the unthinkable. You know, you've got a situation where councils have like just been doing things rather than having to go through six different committees and prove outcomes before they decide that which just works so well for the creative community. That's how we function. We try things to see what sticks to the wall, and if it works, we carry on doing it. And that has become a way, an accepted way of doing things in our society through COVID, which is we need to hold on to that idea of a risk positive. Culture in how we're doing things, and trusting people, collaborating with people, that's come out of the pandemic and we need to hold on to it.
Thank you. I noticed Miss Cullen was nodding her head, I think, when I talked about £10,000 going further in a smaller environment, if you'd like to give your thoughts on that.
Yeah, absolutely. I think often, by their very nature, funding requirements are restrictive and, they, particularly over COVID, sometimes our venues have experienced that they can't apply for funds because they don't have the right business structure or they're not, they don't reach that kind of threshold. And so I think having, alongside having the kind of flexibility of now recognising their comedy and grassroots music venues our culture, I think within general funding there needs to be flexibility as well. What we have experienced during this year, particularly for a lot of our venues, is it's the first time they've ever applied for any type of funding, and kind of learning that skill for the very first time can't sort of be underestimated. It's learning to kind of speak that language of funding is an entirely new thing for a lot of grassroots music venues. And so things that we can do to create more flexible and dynamic funding streams, which don't discriminate against smaller venues is definitely a positive thing. And our sector is incredibly resourceful. It can adapt very quickly. It doesn't often need huge amounts of money to do that. We've seen it with the implementation of live streaming within the grassroots music venues. Small investments, micro investments, can go a long way at the grassroots level. That's what kind of grassroots culture is all about,
Thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask a supplementary just in the back of Ms. Minto's questions. I'm really excited to hear Mr. Baker's enthusiasm for the culture in place, especially since a long-term music charity supporting young people in my area is at the moment building their own bespoke studio and performance space. But it leads me to ask about younger people, because often, and I think this maybe for Ms. Cullen, Mr. Jones, more particularly, young people may be excluded by age because of licensing and premises. And just to ask, what opportunities are there for younger performers and younger audiences to take part in these sort of live music and opportunities? So if I could go to Mr. Jones first, Ms. Cullen, and then I'll go to Mr. Baker.
Yeah, you're right that a lot of our work is focused on an adult audience. We do shows for younger people and families, but probably not enough of them. That's something we're reviewing within our business planning. Something which, having said we're not an organisation that normally requires funding, I think if we were to start to engage in more developmental work, engaging with schools or community groups to access young people, that's precisely the area where we would require a small amount of funding to support that work. But at the moment, I would say that we're focusing on the commercial imperatives and the commercial situation that lie ahead of us at the moment, as we start to regrow the business. But we have said that we want to not necessarily go back to the sort of default settings and do what we used to do pre-COVID, that there is an opportunity to grow back better, grow back differently. And so pioneering some of those kind of initiatives within a comedy context is definitely on our agenda.
Miss Cullen?
Yeah, definitely. I think it's really interesting the role that grassroots music venues can play in that development for school leavers and you know, people sort of 16 and above as development and training hubs, because I think it connects into a wider issue within our sector, which is that of succession. So a lot of the venue managers have been doing this for about 20, 30 years. They have a huge amount of knowledge, but what happens after they leave, or if they, you know, who are they going to train up to take on that role and kind of that next generation within the ecosystem? Because if we don't have that, if a vital person in the organisation leaves, you don't want the venue to close because of that. And so I think getting that idea of succession is incredibly important. And I think it can be done through grassroots music venues diversifying their business and kind of being recognised not only as places that put on music, but actually are kind of central spokes within their community. They open doors for people who want to experience what live music is like and kind of act as that training ground, not just for artists, not just developing artists and in their career, but actually just developing the people who work in these venues as well and getting that knowledge. And I think, I guess my own experience, I'm 27 and I started my career because I liked to hang out at my local record shop, and I was just looking at what they were doing there, and that sparked an interest in live music and music in general. And so I think that kind of access to music, the thinking of these places as places where you can have viable careers and that kind of respect for the culture is incredibly important.
Thank you. And Mr. Baker?
And thank you for asking that question. It's a really important one, one that's been a little bit missing so far. So I think the question of young people generally is a vast one. I mean, in particularly in rural situations where a lot of the chat turns to how do you hold on to the young people? How do you stop everybody disappearing and going to the cities? I think the smarter way to look at that is to think about the opportunities that you're giving them before they reach the point where they want to go away. You want to encourage people to move and to travel and to get new experiences, but give them the idea that they've got something to come back to. The places to play, I think you particularly talked about that, the idea of the pubs are not accessible to young people. I think the idea of the grassroots venues that Clara is talking about is key there, but also and the potential through that community network. But if by investing in those places, giving them that core funding and giving them a cultural role, you effectively make those places a bit cooler for your young people who want to associate with the cool of culture. I think the town centre role is important as well. I was involved in a conversation last night with some young people who were talking about the fact that they don't feel welcome in the town centre. They feel they're being looked at as if they shouldn't be there. Whereas, but they gravitate to a place like ours, which is see as somewhere which is actually a place of safety where they can be themselves. And the fact that the cultural venue spread a bit of that influence of safety out into the public realm. I think we need to think really, really smartly about the way that culture is working for young people, and think about joining up some of that funding around that. What I talked about, networks, is vital too, in the sense of a range of opportunity, because in our situation, if a young person is in Castle Douglas and Castle Douglas is specializing in performance, but you've got a visual artist young person, you need them to be signposted
to the right place in that network. And there's a tendency through the funding models at the moment where an arts organization will kind of like hold on to its young people and not, because they're getting funding to support those young people, and not be signposting them to say, oh, you should actually go and talk to those folk in Stranraer, because that, you know, that's going to be more suited to where you are. We need to really create that culture of collaboration in order to join up those opportunities and give people a real range of what is available to them, and make the best of the resources that we've got, rather than a one-size-fits-all approach.
Thank you. I've got a final question from Ms. Apparently I preempted Ms. Weber's question with my supplementary, so apologies. And can I thank everyone today for their attendance? It's been very helpful. And apologies again for difficulties with onboarding for Ms. Campbell for the TMSE, but we will follow up with her to get answers and invite her to comment on the questions that she wasn't able to answer today. So that concludes our committee for this morning, and I thank you to everyone once again for their contributions, and I'll close this meeting.